morning and welcome to Orange United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Corey, one of the associates here, and we are so glad that God has called you to this place this morning. We are a church that helps people find their place in God's story, and we hope you discover that as you join us. We want to invite you to take a moment to fill out our online attendance pads. You can find that link in the comment section of our Facebook feed. If you're part of our congregation in person this morning, we invite you to take out your phone and to do that there as well. We're so looking forward to having you, and we just want to share a few announcements this week.
Hi, I'm Diana Backus, the Children's Director here at Orange. Sign up today for our Orange Pumpkin Carving Contest, October 25th from 3 to 4:30 in the back parking lot. Sign-ups are on our website, orangemethodist.org/signup. Let us know you're coming. See you soon.
Orange, we are so excited to announce that on November 1st, we are going to be having our first in-person worship services. We'll have both 9 and 11, but we are capping it at 25 individuals at each service. So please sign up to let us know you're coming.
We cannot wait to see those smiling eyes beneath your masks, and go ahead to orangemethodist.org/signups in order to register.
Women of Orange, it is not too late to join us this month for our October book club. We'll be meeting on Friday, October 30th at 7 p.m. via Zoom. I invite you to email me, associatepastor@oumcmail.com, to let me know you're planning to come. We are reading this month, Unorthodox, a memoir. Can't wait to have you join. We are indeed so glad to have you in this place this morning. Whether you are worshiping with us online or in person, we are glad that you have found your place this morning. We do have just one additional announcement. We will be hosting a blood drive on behalf of the American Red Cross this Wednesday in our fellowship hall. So if you'd like to sign up to give blood or to be a volunteer, please respond to one of our signups. You can find those in our emails, or you can go to orangemethodist.org/signups. And now, as we turn our hearts, our minds, our bodies toward God in this hour of worship, I invite you to just simply take a breath. Be here, now, in the presence of God. Join me in our call to worship. Gather near, all you weary and hurting. Here, find rest for your souls. Here, enter into the grace of forgiveness. Here, taste the living water of renewal. Come from busy weeks in anxious worry. Find here stillness, like being led to green pastures. Songs that lift you to the heavens. Prayers that ease the wrinkles from your soul. Come and worship, for God is our maker, our defender, and our guide. Let us worship now as our choir leads, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee, number 430 in your hymnal.
Closer to Orange United Methodist Church. My name is Savannah Wright. I am the ministerial intern for the year here, and I'm so excited to be worshiping with you this morning. Church, we stand in a long line of those who have come before us and those who will come after us, professing a common faith. May we affirm the words of that faith together now in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now that we have affirmed our faith in the presence of God and one another, let us still our hearts for a time of prayer. Church, as always, you can submit or update prayer requests by emailing the church office, and you can find a list of the friends we are praying for in the weekly emails. This week, we continue to lift up Bill Christian, Gray Callahan, Lacey Gerard, Ben Kibler, Bill Blackwood, Benjamin Summers, P.H. Craig, Aiden Lang, Ava Perry, Bill and Lee Page, Dale Anderson, Paul Mann, Wilton Andrews, Fred Brooks, Crystal Dickus, Lynn Hillman, Blaine Thomas, John Harrell, Liz Moore, Cindy Gerber, Reverend Michael Hale, Helen Clark, Marjorie Young and George Wayne, Ray Mann, John Madry, the Filiano family, Nadine Sharp, and Nikki Young's father, Tim Heron. And we are lifting up an urgent prayer request this morning for Rhett Kiesler, who was admitted to UNC last night with a low heart rate and low oxygen saturation. Let us turn to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, each day we awake with new hopes, worries, concerns, and stresses of what this day might bring. We have concerns not yet known and joys yet to be celebrated, but it is you, God, that always provides enough. Lord, help us to remember this. Help us to open our eyes to your working, to your care, to your intentional focus on our individual lives. Help us then to move beyond ourselves. Help us to remember those times when we were okay, when we knew how close you truly are to us, so that we can know, even in those darkest moments, that you are here. Help us to see the places where you call us to true community, to see opportunities to bring hope into our world, joy into the moment. Give us the courage to demonstrate the grace of your Son. God, our world continues to feel pressed and pinched into crisis after crisis. And in this hour of worship and prayer, may we never forget the calling you have placed on all of our lives, all of those gathered here, however we gather, to be people of light who dare to bring your kingdom to earth, just as you first taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Church, as we prepare to hear the word of God read and then proclaimed by Pastor Adam, let us pray together our prayer of illumination. Gracious God, as we turn to your word for us, may the Spirit of God rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in our hearing, in our speaking, in our believing, and in our living. Amen. The scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It reads, If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, And if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Worship with us. This week we have been having significant internet issues, and so while as the live stream has been going in and out and we had a lot of difficulties with the first service, we're hopeful that we're at least able to record this and share it with you at a later time. Also, today we began with our 9 o'clock service inviting in our church council, as next Sunday is the first Sunday that we will begin regathering, inviting the congregation in. We gave thanks for our church council who were able to come and be a part physically, for those that signed up to come in and to be in the building, and we look forward to welcoming you. By them coming in and being a part of the service this morning, it helped us put into practice and test the policies and protocols that we had put into place and to see what we needed to do to make sure that we were fully prepared for next Sunday. And so we do encourage you to go online, and you, through the emails, you should receive a link to be able to sign up to attend worship with us next Sunday. And so thank you for your patience, and thank you for being with us today. Let us pray. Lord God, you are the Lord of all. And we give thanks for the way that you are a God of redemption and restoration. You can redeem all broken things. You can be glorified. And so today we pray that you might be glorified. We give thanks for your holy word as it has been read and now as it is to be proclaimed, by your Holy Spirit that speaks to us, encourages us, uplifts us, strengthens us, guides us. May you transform the words that proceed from my mouth, and as they fall upon our ears and penetrate our hearts, may they be changed into a word of God that we need to hear today, as individuals and collectively as one body. Lord, we pray this in the name of Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, amen. If you have ever attended a wedding, whether it was your own or someone else's, I'd be willing to wager that you heard that passage of scripture that Savannah read just a few moments ago. As the beautiful bride stands there beside the handsome groom, and as they are gathered in front of their family and friends, flanked on their sides by some of those closest to them, and maybe with a tear welling up in the corner of an eye. You've heard the pastor read that particular passage of scripture. And as the minister reads that scripture many times, the words that you hear her read come from this familiar passage. You hear these words: love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Now, if I am the officiant and I've read that passage of scripture, I often will then add some of the wisdom that I've received from a wise man from years ago about that passage. That wise man suggested that the couple should be able to replace the word love with the names of each other. And then I give them an example, and I read through that passage, putting in their names. Just so that you might have an idea of what I'm talking about, I'll just be personal and use my wife's name. So it would sound something like this. Adam is patient. Well, I try. Jennifer is kind. Well, that's obvious. Adam is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Jennifer does not insist on her own way. Adam is not irritable or resentful. Jennifer does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Adam bears all things. Jennifer believes all things. Adam hopes all things. And Adam and Jennifer endure all things. Love never ends. That simple exercise is a way of hoping to personify for them and those that are gathered what love is. That love is not just the words that we say, but love is the words that we live. A few years ago, I had an opportunity to meet Bob Goff, who was a best-selling author of Dream Big and Everybody Always. And at the event that we were sharing in, Bob was basing most of his talks upon his first book, Love Does. One of my favorite lines from that book reads like this: "The world can make you think that love can be picked up at a garage sale or enveloped in a Hallmark card. But the kind of love that God created and demonstrated is a costly one, because it involves sacrifice and presence. It is a love that operates more like a sign language than being spoken outright. It's a brand of love that just doesn't think about good things or agree with them or talk about them. Love does." I love that passage in that book. It just reminds us of how love is not just the words that we say, but it's what we do. And when I read 1 Corinthians chapter 13, commonly known as the love chapter, and when it's read at a wedding before the vows are taken, Paul's words here are to serve as a reminder to that happy couple and really all that are gathered there on that day that love is more than a word. It's an action. Love does. And if love doesn't, well, Paul has a word about that, doesn't he? In that first verse of that passage that was read, it says, "If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal." I'll be honest, I gave a thought for a little bit today about inviting Derek to come up here, bring a drum or cymbals, and then when I would read that line, that maybe he would bang on the drums or the cymbals. But I've recognized that it might be a little too symbolic to do that. And Derek just pantomimed a rim shot for me. You know, these past few weeks, we've been talking about a different set of vows. We've been talking about the vows that we take when we join the church. And as a congregation, we actually renew those vows each and every time that somebody else joins the church. As we welcome them into the church, we recite these words: "With you, we renew our vows to uphold it by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness." Now, when we entered into a relationship with Jesus Christ, we really entered into a life of service. Jesus was the ultimate servant who modeled what it meant to serve others. I mean, who can forget that incredible image in John chapter 13 that took place there in the upper room? It says as Jesus is gathered together with his closest friends, he got up from the table, he took off his outer robe and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with a towel that was tied around him. Later, it continues on. After he's washed them all, it says, after he had washed their feet, he had put on his robe and had returned to the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right, for that is what I am. So if I, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should also do as I have done to you. Very truly, I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them." As I read that, I'm just struck and reminded about how Jesus himself did something that was so remarkable. He humbled himself. And he demonstrated that he was a servant. As Jesus models this for us, like he said, "For I have set for you an example that you should do as I have done to you." We are called into this life of serving others, of demonstrating the love that we have, of showing that love does. And last week, we just had said how generosity is a choice that we make, which is why it is a vow that we take. And likewise, service is a choice that we make, which is why it is a vow that we take. When Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, that could not have been something that he actually wanted to do. Who would have ever wanted to do that? I mean, it was going to be one of the last things that he did for anyone before he was arrested and beaten and crucified. Who would have ever have chosen to have wanted to wash the dirty feet of his closest friends? It might not have been what he wanted to do, but it's what he needed to do. Because in this humble act of service, he was demonstrating just the small amount of love. He was demonstrating the love that he had for them. See, when we love, we do. When we do things that we do not want to do, we do it out of love for the people that we love. We do things that we do not want to do for the causes that we love. And we do things that we do not want to do for the God that we love. We do things because if we don't, then we become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. Some of you know that I take Fridays as my personal day. My Sabbath is what we would call it. Sundays, as I learned early on growing up in the Parsonage family, are not a day of rest for the pastor or the pastor's family. Filled with services and opportunities to meet with people and have meetings, I learned Sundays would not be a day of recreation for the pastor. And so we are encouraged to find another day of the week that we might take to be apart, to be unplugged from the church so that we might be reformed and recreated. And when I first began that practice, I took Fridays and it was delightful because my wife would go off to work, my children would go off to school, and I would sleep in as late as I could. I would get up, I would drink my coffee, and I would lounge around the house and do nothing all day long. I was trying to practice a good and healthy Sabbath. But what I found was, after not doing anything while my wife was away at work and my children were off at school, Saturday came quickly. And Saturday was filled with us running off to different soccer games and different places, birthday parties and different activities. And in the midst of all the busyness of Saturday, we also recognized that we lived in a household with two young boys and two dogs and two cats. And that means our house was a mess at times. And so in between all the activities, instead of getting to do something fun, we would have to spend that time cleaning and picking up and dusting and mopping and sweeping and vacuuming. And so one day, one Friday, I recognized that as I was enjoying my quiet time, I would rather spend my time with my family. And so I began, instead on Fridays of lounging around and doing nothing, I began the practice. I made a choice to serve my family. And so I would get up and I would sweep. I would dust, I would mop, I would vacuum, I would do everything so that come Saturday, we wouldn't have that burden upon us to have to do. I chose to serve the ones that I loved. Now, we don't always do the things that we want to do, but what's funny is now I look forward to the opportunity to demonstrate the love that I profess that I have for my family, because love does. And so we do things that we may not want to do for those that we love. We do things that we may not want to do for the causes that we love and mean something significant for us. I love the way that I see that lived out within the lives of many people right here in the Church of Orange. How people have a passion for helping to meet people's needs, in particular those that might be hungry or struggling through difficult times. I love the passion that we have for helping to feed the hungry, whether it's through volunteers coming in and serving others by helping to prepare for backpack buddies, or those who do what they may not want to do and go stand out in the rain to help hand out food. I saw that just last month where a group of volunteers from this church gathered at a park over in Hillsboro as we partnered with Porch. And it was raining and it was warm and we were standing out there carrying wet boxes that were struggling to stay together, holding all the fruits and vegetables and dry goods that we were distributing to families who were in a time of need. And it was remarkable because as we're wearing masks and raincoats, I found that my glasses not only were fogging up on the inside from my mask, but then were covered on the outside from the rain. We weren't doing that because we wanted to just stand around and rain. We're doing that because there was a love that we have for people, for this cause of helping people in their time of need. I see that in my neighborhood when there's a food drive. I see that in my neighborhood when they're collecting people together to do a Habitat for Humanity house. We do things that we may not want to do for the causes and the needs that we love. And we do things that we may not want to do for God and the manifestation of God as we understand it in the world today, the body of Christ, the church as we know it as Orange. We serve God. And this very day, there are volunteers here in the building who have been a part of helping to prepare for the recording and live stream. There are volunteers of the choir. You have already witnessed their work today as you've watched the hymns. There are opportunities that we have people stepping up each day to help serve. Just yesterday, people were gathered on this campus to begin to clean up and spruce up our campus, so that next Sunday we might begin to have people begin regathering. We wanted to make it ready. And people were out here. Nobody likes to rake, I don't think. Who would have chosen, who would have wanted to be spending all morning using hedge clippers? I was worried today that I wouldn't even be able to use my arms as I preached because of doing a motion that I was unfamiliar with and don't often do. But the people gathered and did that because the love that they have for God and for the body of Christ we know as the church. Just as we have people volunteer and step up and serve through music, through technology, through offering their gifts and their talents, serving on committees. And I'm so grateful for so many people that have been reached out to by our committee of nominations who have agreed to step up and serve in different roles and capacities within the life of the church. We do things we may not want to do because of the love that we have for God. Because love does. If it doesn't, then we are like a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. See, when we step up and we begin to do these things, it becomes more than just a noise. When we claim that we are concerned about the hungry, but we do nothing about it, then we have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. When we proclaim that we're concerned about racial injustice in our community and in our world, but do nothing, then we have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. God has called us into a life of service, and God has called us to put our love into action, because love does. In a couple weeks, you're going to be challenged. On November 8th, we're having a covenant renewal service. And on that Sunday, we're going to be invited to renew our covenant with God and with His church. And those vows that we took when we joined the church, and those vows that we renewed every time someone became a part of the congregation, we're going to invite you to commit. To commit how you will support the church with your prayers. Maybe you will commit at that time, you will acknowledge and let us know that you're going to commit to pray for the church every day, or maybe you'll pray through our prayer list once or twice a week. We want you to let us know how you're going to support the church with your prayers. Maybe you will commit to pray for the pastors, for the staff, for the lay leadership. You're going to commit to pray for our sick and our shut-ins. You're going to commit to pray for our children and our youth. We're going to invite you to commit to how this year you might support the church with your prayers. We're going to invite you to commit how you're going to support the church with your presence. Now, we recognize presence in this year and in the year to come. We don't even really understand yet fully what that might look like. So maybe you will commit to being present with the church by watching live stream video from home or the worship videos as we share them. Or maybe you will commit to being present through a Sunday school class or a small group, some way that is connecting, whether it's by Zoom or even if at some point in time it becomes possible to be present in person. Or maybe it's that you will even commit to being present within your household, within the lives of those that you love. We're going to challenge you. We're going to challenge you to commit to the ways that you're going to support the church over this coming year with your gifts. We know that we give as a sign and demonstration of our gratitude for God's generosity, and we give to His kingdom to be able to see His kingdom come. And so we're going to challenge you and invite you to be able to support the church and make that commitment through your gifts. And as we're talking about today, we're going to invite you to commit to service. Maybe it's first committing to serve those within your household, within your family. Or maybe it's committing to service of a cause that goes beyond ourselves. Or maybe it's even a commitment to serve within the church, being willing to volunteer, to step up, to help in different areas and ministries in the life of the church. We want to renew those commitments because it's putting the love that we have into action. Because as we've said today, love does. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we give thanks for the love that you have for us and the love that was made known to us through Jesus Christ. We give thanks for that incredible gift and the ways that He demonstrated that love that He had for us when He offered Himself up on a cross as a sacrifice for that which we ourselves could not do. Today, as we give thanks for that incredible gift that we have received and we seek to respond to it with love, Lord, may you help us find the ways that we might be able to serve one another, to serve for those causes that are important and near and dear to us, and to serve you and your body. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ and through the power of the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, Amen. Today, as we do give thanks for all that God has given to us, I give thanks for the ways that I have seen you responding with such generosity during this time. We are just so grateful for the way that you have continued to help Orange be a place that helps people find their place in God's story. And you are giving in such a way that we truly are impacting our community. We can continue to respond to God's generosity by going to orangemethodist.org/give, and there you can make your contribution, or you can text the word orange to the number 73256, and there you'll receive a response to the way how you might be able to give online. We truly give thanks for all of your generosity, and we look forward to seeing how we may continue to be a blessing to our community and beyond. Up a special word of thanks to Doris Click for that fun and jazzy rendition of This Little Light of Mine. And now, as we draw towards the close of our service, I invite you to continue to worship as we sing the hymn servant song found on The Faith We Sing, page number 2222. Thank you for your patience and understanding today. And now, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, may you go forth carrying the love of Christ and demonstrating that love through your service. Amen.